When did that change? When did TIFF become a major award season player?
I'd say probably 2000 with American Beauty in a significant way. And since then, I'd say over the last 14 years, we've had so many of the People's Choice Award films winners go on to Best Picture. Mm-hmm. So I think Toronto's actually kind of acted as a bellwether. I think five of the last 10 or so have gone on to win the Oscar for Best Picture, and lots of other nominations as well and awards.
Was that ever planned in the timing? Like it's at a perfect time of the year, right, for that to work.
So the festival in the early days was in October. The very first festival was in October, and then the second year they moved it in September. And I don't think anyone really knew. I mean, this was 38 years ago. They didn't have a clue because release patterns were very, very different at that point in time, you have to remember. So it's only been, I would say, in the last 15 years that Toronto's become a serious platform for Oscar films. I mean, it happened in the 90s, for sure, but it wasn't, it was more for best foreign language films, and maybe some, you know, actors would get nominated, et cetera, et cetera, and big pictures did as well. And we had films like Princess Bride, for instance, that went on to a lot of nominations, and others, but it was really, American Beauty was the film that put us on the map in terms of awards. It really did, because it was a film that came here. DreamWorks didn't really know what they had with that film. They thought it was a dark film. They wanted to take it to a festival, see how it played. Of course, it played through the roof here. It won our audience award, and then they built their campaign around that, and then it went on to win Best Picture and a lot of other awards as well. So at that point in time, I think for the studios, it's not just about awards, by the way. It's also about clout in the box office, in the marketplace. So at that point in time, there were a number of films that broke out of Toronto that went crashed through the $100 million box office barrier in North America. That's significant. And I mean, the studios love awards and all that kind of stuff. But I think they're always a little skeptical about going to festivals because the film is kind of perceived as somewhat marginal, more for an arty audience, cinephiles. But when Toronto broke through that barrier, and there was so many films, I mean, I can't remember all the names at this point in time, but there were a lot of films that broke through that $100 million barrier, and Hollywood then really paid attention, because not only was it for awards, but it was also for the box office. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, of course, that's what it's all about.
How do you decide, you're talking about cinephiles and arty films, how do you decide, I mean, there's no massive, you know, those tentpole summer blockbusters at film festivals usually.
Sure.
How do you decide between art and commerce, I guess, in that regard?
Actually, Toronto, I think we don't decide. It's a mix of the two. It really, we embrace all different zones of cinema, genres of cinema. It's the complete gamut, actually, from the biggest films with the biggest stars in the world to incredibly small, low budget, experimental, weird, wacky, you know, films that are shot for $10,000 on cell phones, that kind of thing.
Is there anything like that this year? That's interesting.
Well, we've got a film, one of the films that I love a lot, actually, an Iranian film shot in France because she's left Iran, is a film that uses, I'd say, 50% cell phone footage from the Green Revolution in 2008. The rest of it's shot in an apartment, but it shows how some people with no resources at all can make it. This is a really wonderful film, by the way.
What's it called?
Red Rose, Iranian film, Iranian-French production. And it's, you know, an example of one of those films where with just pure creativity and imagination, you can make a stunning piece of work, and it'll be picked up in festivals. But there's a lot of very cheap, low-budget films that we show in the festival. And you have everything in between, you know, the full mm-hmm. gamut, mid-budget films. And there's a lot of major stars now who are dropping down from the tentpole films. You know, they obviously earn a great living and get paid great salaries for those.
So they can make the good ones.
Exactly. Yeah. But they want to, you know, they want to be challenged. They want to work in more interesting works. They don't want to just do special effects stuff. I mean, that must be, you know, challenging in its own way. But, you know, performing in front of green screen all the time must have its limitations. So I think they sort of want to deal with, you know, more human, intimate stories. Maybe subject-oriented, you know, films about politics, films about contemporary situation, poverty, immigration, whatever. So you have a lot of major stars actually appearing in those types of films. I mean, our opening night film, The Judge, you know, has a huge cast. Robert Downey Jr., Robert Duvall, Billy Bob Thornton, and they're in a film that is kind of throwback in a way. I mean, it's a mm-hmm. small, intimate drama. It's really well-made, father and son story. But it's not a tentpole film. You know, it's not full of special effects. It's really a human relationship story.
I'm glad you talked about it a little bit because, like I said, I'm not allowed to mention basically anything. But tell me about some stuff that surprised you this year.
There's a terrific first Canadian film, which I'm kind of advocating for, a film called Corbeau, first-time film done by a young director, Mathieu Denis. I was very impressed with this. It deals with the Canadian terrorism in the 60s, the FLQ.
Oh, yeah.
So well before, you know, became sort of a current topic of interest with Al-Qaeda and 9/11. And this is a really smart, intelligent, well-made film. Beautifully shot, too, by the way. And wonderful performances by a really young cast. I was really impressed with this film. I saw a terrific second feature by a young French woman filmmaker called The Great Man, Le Grand Homme, which I loved as well. It deals with a couple of people, French Foreign Legion, believe it or not, who are in Afghanistan. That's where the film starts, but it turns into a father-son relationship as well as this Foreign Legion soldier moves back to France. I was very impressed with that film. One of my favorites as well is a very strange French film, again directed by a woman, a lot of women directors, Pascal Ferrand, called Bird People.
Josh Charles.
Sorry?
Josh Charles.
Exactly. Yeah, he's in the film. And I won't spoil this film at all, but it's completely unexpected in terms of the narrative turn it takes.
Seems to be what he's doing these days, just unexpected things.
Which is great. I mean, you know, it's terrific when an actor sort of does those kinds of things, shakes up their career. Mm-hmm. Steve Carell in one of the most interesting films of the year, as Foxcatcher, which I think will go on to many nominations. He is brilliant in the film, absolutely brilliant. And this is a Steve Carell you will not recognize.
I didn't know it was him.
Yeah, you don't know
it's him. I tried
going. It's a really smart, intelligent film. I was very, very impressed with that. Mr. Turner, you know, film of the great, great British painter,
mm-hmm.
J.M.W. Turner, Michael Lee's film, I thought was superb. There's a wonderful, another French film, because I see a lot of French films, and I love French cinema, called May Allah Bless You, which is based on a true story of the filmmaker himself and his experiences as a French Islamic, as a French Muslim in contemporary French society, which I thought was brilliant. Black and white, unbelievably well shot, and also really, really smart. Provocative. Roger Waters, The Wall, you know, for those Pink Floyd fans who are looking for, you know, kind of a blast out, you know, experience. It's really quite something, and a very personal film for Roger, because it goes back to the roots of The Wall in all kinds of ways. You know, explores his own family history, which is very moving. His father and grandfather were both killed in the two world wars. So that, you know, a film I think is really quite extraordinary too. But there's, you know, a lot of stuff in between. But those are probably, you know, some of the highlights that I would you know, drop in on.
Everyone, when I said I was talking to you, everyone asked me the same question. How do they choose the movies? I know you've probably answered that question a gazillion times, but everyone, so how do you choose the movies?
Well, I think what you're looking for, I mean, you choose the movies by traveling the world and going to film festivals, and then there's a lot of private trips we take to screening rooms and all over the world. But in terms of what we're looking for, you're looking for something that intrigues you, that challenges you, that really excites you individually as a programmer. You're also looking for something that you think is going to play to a wider audience. But of course, you're the first audience in many cases. Mm-hmm. We're seeing this film as the public for the very first time. We're often the very first outsider who's seen the movie. So that's pretty terrific. And if you get really excited about a film, I mean, that says something. It really does. So those films, I think, are the easy ones, you know, the ones that really excite you. Yeah, it's absolutely a slam dunk. I mean, when I saw Slumdog Millionaire for the very first time in a London screening room, it was like, wow, you knew this was going to work with an audience. It was so fantastic. It just pulled all the right buttons or hit all the right buttons. And so, you know, there's those types of films. Then there's other types of films which are a little quieter, a little bit more difficult, a little bit more challenging. You're looking for those as well. You realize it's a different kind of audience. Slumdog Millionaire is obviously populous for a mass audience. But you're also looking to make sure that the cinephiles are really, really happy, that there's critically intelligent, engaged, smart films. You're looking for films that do say something about the world, that they're dealing with topical issues, maybe in a difficult way. You know, some films may be more subject-oriented and not as professional in terms of their filmmaking. Others may be incredibly slick, but they kind of lack something. There's a little bit of an empty core. So you're looking for something that, I think, engages all of those different elements, you know, the mind, the heart, as well as technically. It's really put together well. But I think that's probably a secondary interest. It's more, does it hit you? Does it engage you? And is it really going to grab a large audience?
Talk about Slumdog and just the way it looked and the way it was shot, at least the way I've perceived filmmaking, it's changed everything with the DSLRs and everything. How has it changed filmmaking the way you've seen it?
I think there's obviously a lot more experimentation. I mean, Slumdog was one of those films. It was the digital revolution was just beginning in a funny way. This is about 7-8 years ago. I mean, we all knew it was coming. Filmmakers were kind of exploring it, dealing with it. They weren't quite sure. A lot of people were still shooting in film. Some are. But it was, you know, the technology was just starting to become really professional, where people like Danny, et cetera, felt comfortable with it. And I agree, it's got that kind of in the streets, on the run, mm-hmm. feel to it. It's really energetic. And it captures the energy of children really, really well. And I'm not sure that a 35 millimeter camera, really heavy, mm-hmm. or even, you know, Steadicam could have captured that in the same way. So I think it actually did, you know, lead to a certain kind of technical breakthrough, just in terms of being more spontaneous, being with your actors, you know, being closer to them. And I think the digital revolution has certainly done that. I mean, some filmmakers, the debate's still on, there's certain filmmakers that are still, you know, shooting in film.
Yeah, Chris Nolan won't.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And all the power to them. His films are amazing.
Precisely. Yeah.
On the other end of the digital stuff, distribution, I wanted to talk to you about, just because it's completely changed in the last year or two. Like, it's all, and it's still changing. Netflix and internet, and maybe that, I don't know what it's called. I guess it's the second tier. I guess it goes theaters, then there's a second tier, and then
VOD,
video.
Exactly. Yeah. Broadcast.
So how does that work for TIFF? Like, would you prefer it if films just went straight theater to I guess, VOD or DVD or whatever we call it now?
Compute. Some do, actually. Out of TIFF. Yeah.
Does it help?
It helps the filmmakers. I mean, I think anything that helps a filmmaker at the end of the day is good for the industry, of course. So for certain young filmmakers who probably aren't going to get theatrical mm-hmm. distribution, especially when it comes to foreign language films, which is very difficult to get into the North American marketplace, this is an option and an opportunity for them. Last year we had a deal with Vimeo, and I think it was picked up by a number of filmmakers where they offered a distribution deal to certain filmmakers. And I think, you know, a good dozen filmmakers or so picked up that deal. I think otherwise those films just would not have, they'd had the two festival screenings or three festival screenings here, that's it. They wouldn't have had any life. So there is this, you know, life, the so-called long tail for a number of filmmakers. I think the major films are still always going to go through the traditional model at this point in time. They'll do theatrical, you know, 3 months later it's on DVD, VOD, sometimes it's, you know, simultaneous VOD, or it's a slight delay in VOD and then broadcast, et cetera, all the ancillaries. And I think it's going to take a little while for all of those so-called windows to start narrowing, where you actually see everything happening on the same day. There's been some experiments, of course, around the world where, you know, day and day, like everything mm-hmm. breaks at the same time, theatrical, VOD, DVD, so it just all goes out. In some cases, VOD or DVD has actually preceded a theatrical release. You know, people are out there playing and experimenting. There's not a lot of it. And a lot of those experiments haven't gone very, you know, they haven't been very successful. So I think jury's still out, but that's fine. I mean, these are the guys leading the way. Mm-hmm. At some point in time, I think the windows are really, really going to narrow. But of course, you know, the exhibitors are very, very nervous about this because they want to push people into cinemas.
And how does that change for you as cinema, as people start having these massive TVs in their house and people are watching movies on phones? How does it change the theater experience?
Well, we're running theaters year-round in our building. We've got mm-hmm. five screens. But I still think there's a desire on the part of many people to actually see a film on the big screen. And to be honest, my feeling is that tablets and you know, phones, et cetera, are not our enemy. They're the opposite, actually. They're your friend. They're educational. They expose the work to a much wider audience, who at the end of the day are intrigued and want to see 2001, which they've seen on their cell phone or on a tablet. They actually want to see a 70 millimeter print. So we're running the Kubrick exhibition this fall in our building. It's going to be a complete exhibition of many of the artifacts, et cetera, from Kubrick's movies, but doing a complete retrospective of Kubrick's work. We'll have many of the guests, including his wife, will be here, Douglas Trumbull, who did the special effects for 2001. So I still think, in fact, whenever we show 2001, we have our own 70 millimeter print, it packs the place. So there's still that curiosity about seeing it on the big screen. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing quite like the communal live experience. I mean, that's one of the reasons the festival is so successful. The fact that we're delivering a lot of the real live movie stars and directors in front of a live audience. There's, you know, that synergy, that connection is fantastic. It's like live sports, you know, of course, you know, all these things are being televised around the world, et cetera, there's nothing like going to the World Cup live. I mean, I watch the World Cup on, you know, I'm a huge football fan, I watch it on television, but there's nothing like, you know, whenever I'm in London, I go to live football matches because I love it, soccer matches.
What's your team? Your club, sorry.
Tottenham Hotspur.
Okay.
Ever since I was a kid, I went to an English boarding school, so Spurs are still my team.
Gotcha.
Yeah. They lost on the weekend, sadly.
It's all right. I think you have plenty on your mind to keep it.
They had a good start to the season, and they won their first two games, but yeah.
Michael Moore, 25th anniversary, Roger Moore.
Yeah, right. I remember the first, I remember that year, actually, really, really well. A couple of memories. In those days, entering your film into a festival was very different. And of course, you know, people always want to know, how do you enter a film into a festival? Well, many people have friends, producers, reps, distributors, et cetera, Michael had none of that stuff. He just simply sent in his DVD, okay? In those days, it was probably a video cassette.
VHS,
it wasn't even a DVD, it was a VHS. But where he was smart was he actually phoned the head of print traffic. This is the guy who received all those video cassettes in those days, and started to talk up the movie. And Michael is a natural salesperson. He really, really is. And the word of mouth just started to travel through the staff. Here was this guy, Roger Moore. He was promising on bringing up a whole bunch of people from Flint, Michigan. It was going to be a fantastic screening, et cetera, et cetera. We all started talking about the movie before we even saw it. When we saw the film, the film was terrific. It's a documentary, et cetera, et cetera. We had no idea how big it was going to be. Mm. So we actually ran it in a really small cinema, about 300 seats. And these were the days before you didn't choose your films before you arrived at the festival. You just lined up and went, right? Mm. Okay? So it was first come, first served. Well, we realized we made a mistake when we went to this cinema, and there were thousands of people lined up outside. Thousands. None of them could, the first 300 got in. The other 2,000 people weren't going to get in. We've since worked out, the subtleties of the system, the ticketing system. But it was, the public knew about this film before. I don't know how they found out. I mean, Michael was, as I say, a natural promoter. He just sort of managed to make things happen. And that film went on to win our audience award, People's Choice Award that year, and got picked up, major distribution deal. I think Warner Brothers bought it for a multi-million-dollar deal. And that put, Michael Moore on the map.
How do you think he changed documentary filmmaking?
Did he? In lots of ways he did, because I don't think the documentary filmmaker at the time aspired to theatrical release. Mm-hmm. And suddenly you had this filmmaker breaking through with a very popular subject. Of course, it was incredibly contemporary. It was all about unemployment in the States. And there was an audience for this. Warner Brothers took a huge gamble. I'm not quite sure why. This is a major studio. It wasn't even one of the smaller, boutique distributors at that point in time. This is a major studio stepping to the plate. And it just kind of broke through for documentary filmmaking. Of course, I would say the last 10 or 15 years since, Roger Me was, 20, 25 years ago?
Yeah.
Was it 25?
20. I think you guys are promoting the 25th anniversary of Roger Me.
So Roger Me was 25 years ago, and I would say in the last 15 years, last 20 years, a lot of documentaries have actually gone on to theatrical release, mm-hmm. and there's been a growing interest in documentaries. I think people have kind of discovered the joys of documentary filmmaking, what you can do in terms of storytelling, good subject. I mean, truth is stranger than fiction in all kinds of ways, and I think there's still that desire maybe the movies have moved more towards special effects, the kind of outlandish comic book heroes. People are looking actually for a relief from that. They want a sense of just how daily people live their lives, mm-hmm. and or just insights into, people like, I can't even remember his name now, Roger, who, et cetera, it was the, I think the CEO of General Motors. Mm-hmm. So they kind of want that insight into the, the back scenes. I mean, Errol Morris has done a fantastic job with, films on Donald Rumsfeld, et cetera, et cetera. So, there's definitely that, in the hands of skilled documentary filmmakers, they can make a subject completely fascinating.
So can Bill Murray. That was a terrible segue. but the other question people had for me was, what is Bill Murray Day?
That great documentary filmmaker.
Yeah. He probably would be if he tried his hand at it.
Yeah, he would probably.
He's good at everything.
Yeah, it'd be certainly funny and engaging and interesting. So Bill Murray's come to the festival with a film called St. Vincent. And people love Bill Murray. They really do. Kind of enigmatic, funny man in all kinds of ways. And of course, he's got a strong association with Ivan Reitman. And we're in the building that was formerly Ivan Reitman and his two sisters' father's property. Mm-hmm. So we have that kind of connection as well. So we're going to be showing three films, I guess, on Bill Murray Day: Stripes, Ghostbusters, and Groundhog Day. So two of Ivan's films and the Harold Ramis. And I expect that Bill will be around that day in some kind of, way, shape, or form. And there'll be hopefully some announcements in terms of what his, involvement will be. But very exciting for us, obviously. I mean, a major icon. And it goes to show you again the breadth of the festival. The fact that we're attracting somebody like Bill Murray who comes, gives up a day like this of his life, or, says, let's do a Bill Murray Day at the film festival. And
were you able to get in contact with him? Because I hear he's basically impossible to get in contact.
I haven't talked to Bill Murray. No, I have not. I have certainly met him a number of times. Wonderful, charming guy, very funny. But I'm not sure you can actually reach him by phone.
Yeah, there's a...
You have to go through a lot of interviews.
Yeah, there's a whole article someone wrote about it recently. Yeah. Talk about Ivan Reitman. Jason Reitman's got a film this year, Men, Women, and Children, Labor Day last year.
Yeah.
He's really... for me, I think he's the best filmmaker in the world. I don't know where he sits for you, but how have you seen his progression over the years?
We started with Jason's short films, yeah. and then we ran his first feature film, Thank You for Smoking, years ago, and then went on to Juno and Up in the Air. So, you know, we've had a long association with him. We've shown basically every single one of his features, always on the same day, same time, same theater. I think it's a Ryerson 7 o'clock on the first Saturday of the festival. Yeah, he's very superstitious that way, and he insists on that time slot. I agree. Jason's, I think, you know, what I love about Jason's work is he's beginning to range through. It's very difficult to actually get a sense in terms of who he is as a filmmaker, because he's ranging through so many different genres and so many different topics. I mean, this is highly topical, you know, it's about kids and parents and the internet world. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think people are going to be blown away by it because of what he does technically with the film. So, I mean, he's got an eye for a subject. He's really got his pulse, I think, on the contemporary. And I just admire him so much because he's prepared to take chances as a filmmaker, do different things, and you know, he's working with some tremendously talented people as well at the same time.
Is there anyone else like that, the superstitious, that always wants same day, time, and all that kind of stuff?
Nobody quite like Jason. No, nobody quite like Jason. People, no, you know, every film I think is different for them. So, you know, some filmmakers want early in the festival, some people like this particular house, but for others they don't really care. It's in the hands of their distributor. I mean, you know, David Cronenberg, he's opened the festival, he's had galas. You know, sometimes it's Roy Thompson Hall, sometimes it's the Elgin, sometimes it's Princess of Wales. David, at the end of the day, just kind of takes the guidance of his distributor. You know, he has a feel for it, but he doesn't really insist. But, you know, Jason, absolutely, that's his slot, and, you know, he owns that slot whenever he has a movie.
That's cool. I only have a few minutes left, so I do want to talk about Closing Down King Street, because that's kind of cool.
It's very cool.
And what's going to be happening?
So we moved into this building 4 years ago, and we did a partial street closure last year. And this year is going to be complete street closure from the first Thursday to Sunday, and then partial afterwards from University to... I guess Peter Street. Mm-hmm. So very exciting for us. We're going to have all kinds of activations, music, food, actors, acrobats, you know, just wait and see. But there's a lot of music. We're building a stage. And it'll be fantastic because people who just want to come down and stargaze and just sort of soak up the festival atmosphere and not necessarily see a film will be able to come down here. If they want to see a film, of course, there'll be millions of people lined up at Roy Thompson Hall, Princess of Wales, Scotiabank just around the corner, and our own building. So the place will really be buzzing. But I think it's phenomenal. We closed down the street when we opened the building for like a half a day, I think it was, and it was really quite something. It was so exciting. I mean, to turn this into a pedestrian mall for the first 4 days is going to be incredible. You've got so many guests from around the world. I mean, 4,000 industry delegates from international from around the world, another 1,000, you know, it's about 5,000-6,000 professionals working Toronto. And then, of course, you've got the Toronto audience, too. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot of people are just going to come down and soak up the atmosphere. Hopefully, you know, the weather's going to be good. It looks like it's going to be great this weekend. And they'll just get an opportunity to kind of see stars, maybe, hear some music, have a fun time, you know, eat in the restaurants across the way, and just sort of, you know, have a great time.
It's a good way to close it.
Yeah, great.
Cool. Terrific. Thanks, Piers.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
My pleasure.